Merge la bun. Yes, what's your point of order?
No, Madam Speaker, sorry to interrupt and I don't mean to challenge your authority. But there is a reason why we come early to queue. I was the first one to arrive in this chamber this morning. The only person who sat ahead of me was Senator Orengo Kang'ata. Since then, four other, or five actually, if you include Senator Matangi, have been granted the opportunity to speak. I don't think that is fair.
Senator, you will, I'll give you the opportunity next, so please go, continue.
That's unfair. Why do we come?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, thank you very much, and I want to begin, Madam Speaker, by taking the opportunity to thank and congratulate, Madam Speaker, the team that was appointed by this House, that is a team led by Senator Omogeni and the other senators in the Committee on Legal Affairs, that then did the work that culminated in the report that we have. And in congratulating them, Madam Speaker, I believe that it is also a time when, as the House, we have to answer affirmatively to the same question that we asked. Because the question has been asked here continuously, Madam Speaker, does Parliament act or exist in vain as far as this process is concerned, Madam Speaker? And the first answer I want to provide to that, Madam Speaker, in my view, is that that question was answered affirmatively when we first held the discussion in the Speaker's office when allowing that committee to join with the Committee of the National Assembly. And indeed, in that sitting, the question was, should they invite public participation? And it was arrived in the affirmative that indeed that committee can invite public participation, collect views, albeit then that information and those views inform the report of the committee, Madam Speaker. And I think it is at that point that that decision was made that Parliament does not exist and is not a conveyor belt in this process, Madam Speaker. But then even the more fundamental question, as I make my points on the bill itself, I think the more fundamental question is this. Then, ourselves as senators, do we want then our committee to have acted in vain in the report that they have tabled here, Madam Speaker? Because the committee has preferred views, opinions, and positions that they have arrived at after deliberations, and they have tabled a report which we have all agreed, Madam Speaker, that is supposed to inform the debate and help to shape the opinion of members. And the reason I raise this point, Madam Speaker, is this, because if you listen to our continued debate, while the committee was clear, and that is what the chairperson started with, he said that we have resolved after our deliberations and collections of views at the tail end of the report. We have said that one, the report can be adapted, the bill can be passed, and then members of the public will have the decision. But even more fundamental is on the question of, did the committee resolve the question of Article 257 and whether this is a bill that is promoted by the people of the Republic of Kenya? And Senator Morgan was very clear here when he said that the committee of Senate resolved that question. And that's why I said, I think it's also, as we ventilate, as we bring out our issues, it's also important for us to ask ourselves, do we also want our committee to have acted in vain? But having said that, Madam Speaker, I want to associate myself with most of the views that my colleagues have aired here. And in recognizing, Madam Speaker, that this bill is a bill that has proposed a spectrum of issues, extremely wide, Madam Speaker, so wide such that one would say that it was a very daring venture to attempt to make amendments to the Constitution in so many aspects of it, Madam Speaker. But at the end of the day, the process has culminated in the bill that we have today, and most of those issues have been dissected and opinions and opposition arrived at, and we're able to proceed from there, Madam Speaker. And in my view, Madam Speaker, I believe that the bill has addressed, in that wideness of issues, specific issues that we should be able to say firmly that are issues since we promulgated our constitution 2010 have been matters that still required the input of legal minds, of deeper thinking, so that we can arrive at more current day issues, Madam Speaker, and positions that will help us make progress. And I say so, Madam Speaker, recognizing that indeed the constitution itself, our constitution 2010, envisaged that it is possible and allowable to amend it. And I want to laud the team that started this process, Madam Speaker, in recognizing that there are various gains that we must say honestly are there. Madam Speaker, in the introduction of the new Article 11A, Madam Speaker, well, we all know as Kenyans that the backbone of our economy, Madam Speaker, is on largely the SMEs, the small traders, the small business people, the small farmers, Madam Speaker. This bill has proposed that that we build an economic system that supports small and micro enterprises, Madam Speaker. And I was one of the sponsors, Madam Speaker, of a bill in this House that supports SMEs, Madam Speaker, to ensure that when government is doing its planning, when funds are being allocated, that there is a specific fund and kitty that goes directly to ensuring that SMEs, small traders, business people are strengthened in this republic, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, one of the issues we have been grappling with all along is on the question of what responsibility do we have as citizens to ensure that we have a country where corruption is dealt with finality, Madam Speaker. And I also want to, Madam Speaker, point out the new article, Madam Speaker, 18A, on the responsibilities of a citizen, Madam Speaker. And in this, I do so because most of the time we have been reduced to just making noise, to just complaining, to just lamenting. But in this article, Madam Speaker, it clearly spells out that it is now the responsibility of every citizen to practice ethical conduct and combat corruption, Madam Speaker, so that we don't have to sit here all the time and wait and ask in the House of Parliament, what is EACC doing, Madam Speaker? What is the DCI doing? That indeed this responsibility is now constitutional to each one of us, Madam Speaker. In Article 89, Madam Speaker, and this is a discussion I would like to end with, Madam Speaker, on the creation, 89-1, Madam Speaker, on the creation of the 360 constituencies, Madam Speaker, from 290. I'll close the few remarks I have on that particular issue, Madam Speaker, because I have a word or two on it. The other article, Madam Speaker, I may want to point out at is, Madam Speaker, the article that has been amended, Article 96.3, Madam Speaker. And in so doing, I want to remember, as a member of this House who has sat in the Public Accounts Committee from the year 2013 to the year 2015, and Madam Speaker, one of the things that we had to combat with, the governor then from Nairobi, immediately when the Auditor General tabled the first report into this House, Madam Speaker, governors came together and they proceeded to court, and indeed it was the then governor from Nairobi who proceeded to a court in Kirinyaga, Madam Speaker, and obtained orders. Those orders which said that the Senate is only limited to oversight of funds allocated to counties by national government and have no role in resources that are collected locally in counties, Madam Speaker. And this was a big blow. When the Auditor General is reporting to the Senate, he reports together with all the revenue that is collected at county level, but we were barred by law, Madam Speaker, and by a court ruling that we could not, Madam Speaker, look at the funds that have been allocated in our counties, knowing very well the problems that we have even today of accountability at county government level, Madam Speaker. And that's why I want to say that I believe that following this amendment, now we can freely and lawfully make sure that we look at what is happening at our county levels, government level, and indeed the funds that are collected locally within our counties, Madam Speaker, without delving so much into it, because that's an area where we can speak until tomorrow, Madam Speaker. On the question of the composition of how this house will look like, Madam Speaker, that one I've expressed myself before as the Senator for Kiambu, and I've said, Madam Speaker, that I believe that as history judges what we did as the senators who sat here before, the jury is out there as to did we do our best to represent a more strengthened Senate to ensure that the representation that will be here is one that will be firm, strong, and the one that will carry on the work that this House has done, Madam Speaker. And I believe that if we had stuck to the process of elections that had been proposed in our earlier system, whereby we have 47 elected senators, that would have been better off. But now that this proposal is there to have 94 members sitting in this House, Madam Speaker, so be it. Madam Speaker, on the question of Article 107A and the creation of the office of a leader of official position, Madam Speaker, I want to express my views strongly on this and say I believe that it is a positive move. In this sense, Madam Speaker, because for the last many years in this House, when we've been here for the last 8 years, Madam Speaker, one of the questions that have been bugging the minds of Kenyans is this: do we still have a robust opposition that can put government on its toes? Can we have hard questions being asked by somebody who is not saying that I'm still a part of the system and so we have to comply? And in forward looking, I believe, Madam Speaker, that it is the right time that we should have an official opposition leader in the House, whereby for posterity we are able to look that person and that team in the eye and ask them, have you seen what the government of the day is doing, Madam Speaker? And we have a history that speaks for itself. I've listened to Senator James Orengo here many times when he narrates how, as a House, they put up a fight, Madam Speaker, to have the repeal of Section 2A, Madam Speaker. And we do not want to get to a position, again, in the history of our country, Madam Speaker, when we do not have an opposition that is firm and, Madam Speaker, that is independent of government. Madam Speaker, on the question of this House, Madam Speaker, since we came into this House in 2013, most of the time when the leadership of this House has had to stand and make our case, we have been ridiculed. There's a time I remember personally sitting in a meeting, and our leader of majority was in that meeting. And you know, the comment that was made was that, do you know that even your position is not in the Constitution? So what are you coming to tell us, Madam Speaker? That was a comment that was made when I was there. And that is why I want to laud the inclusion of that Article 108A, which now ensures that the leadership of the Senate is now entrenched in the Constitution, and it is no longer a case that can be used either in jest to ridicule, Madam Speaker, or to look like it is a favor that you have a leader sitting in a bicameral system in the upper House who is a majority leader but unrecognized by the Constitution, Madam Speaker. And so that's what I think, even as we look at the issues where one would say, has there been good proposals in this bill, Madam Speaker? I believe those are some of the positive, Madam Speaker, aspects of this bill that one may be able to look at, and the structure of leadership in this House, Madam Speaker, have been made clear there, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, it follows then in these amendments, Madam Speaker, that cabinet secretaries have been renamed, Madam Speaker, into cabinet ministers. I don't know whether, in my view, it is okay that it has been done, but you know, we must entrench this thinking in Kenyans that it is not the type and title of the name that you carry. You've been called a minister or being called a secretary or whatever, that does not lessen or diminish the kind of work that you do. It is the requirement of your office that you need to deliver. And it is all right now that you'll be calling them Madam Speaker, you'll be calling them cabinet ministers. In my view, it was, I believe it was just a question of a hangover of names that were used before. But I did not believe that it had essentially any input in ensuring that, that there is any value input, but because it is the view of Kenyans, and the committee has told us that indeed as Article 257, that it is the views of our people that we are talking about, Madam Speaker, that be as it may. Madam Speaker, in Article 142, there's the amendment that requires the expansion of time for the Supreme Court to determine when a matter of the presidential election, Madam Speaker, has been raised. And I also want to commend that proposal to increase that duration to 30 days, Madam Speaker, given the fact that I was one of those during the first presidential petition who was very pessimistic, Madam Speaker, and I must confess to that. Because when the panel of Supreme Court judges sat and looking at the first presidential petition, Madam Speaker, one of the most curious things was that they were all new justices of the High Court. None of them, actually, at that time, had even penned a single ruling anywhere, Madam Speaker. And we're asking ourselves, what kind of ruling are they going to come up with? Madam Speaker,
continue, order members. You know, Madam Speaker, what you do if you have if you have to say something. So, Senator, continue.
Madam Speaker, my view, Madam Speaker, was that at that time, and I've expressed my own views then, was that it was it possible for those justices then to come within that short period of 14 days, come up with a reasoned ruling, Madam Speaker? Yes, they did, and it was reasoned, and it was well. And what I'm saying, Madam Speaker, is now that at least you have 30 days, Madam Speaker, when a ruling now can be reasoned and passed on, Madam Speaker, then we are better off with the 30 days, Madam Speaker.
What's the point of information, Senator?
Madam Speaker, lest it remains on record on a statement made by Inquirium, Madam Speaker, the distinguished Senator for Kiambu has alleged that the first presidential petition, I believe is meaning the one of 2013, was presided over by judges who had never sat in court and made any ruling. I want to correct that misleading impression that we had distinguished judges of the Supreme Court at the time, my own Professor Jackson Ojwang, my sister, whom we had practiced law with Kaplana Rawal, we had Justice Tunoi, a very distinguished judge. We had Muhammad Ibrahim, who had been in the court for a long time. So the distinguished Senator for Kiambu is responsible for the veracity and accuracy of the statement he makes on the floor, and he should not mislead Kenyans.
Senator, be adequately informed. Be adequately informed.
Madam Speaker, I think maybe if it's my memory that fails me, but there's the element of most of them not having sat, Madam Speaker. You know, but Madam Speaker, that was my view. And as I continue, Madam Speaker, on the question of Madam Speaker, the creation of the office of the Prime Minister, Madam Speaker, I believe it is in order to rename the office of the majority leader in the House, Madam Speaker, to have the title of Prime Minister. Madam Speaker, lest my time runs out, I want to go to one of the issues that I believe is of a lot of importance to me, Madam Speaker, of which I felt, and I would hold the liberty to disagree with the committee, Madam Speaker, on the question of, is it constitutional, Madam Speaker, or unconstitutional for the committee, for the promoters of the bill, to have proposed to create the 70 constituencies, Madam Speaker, and indeed allocate them, Madam Speaker. And I want to argue, Madam Speaker, and make my point here, that it is my firm faith and belief that nowhere that I've produced in this constitution, Madam Speaker, has it suggested, as proposed by the committee, that they have made reservations to the extent that the proposition to have the 70 constituencies and have them allocated either its or usurps into the powers of IBC, Madam Speaker. There is nowhere between Article 88 and all the way Article 89 to the end, where it proposes at all that the IEBC ever had in our past constitution the power to either create or allocate any sub-county or constituency, Madam Speaker. There is none, Madam Speaker. And I have my facts here. I will make my argument, and any person, Madam Speaker, who has a contrary view can come to this floor and make the same, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, in Article 88, Madam Speaker, which creates IEBC.
Senator Ambua, and for me, I prefer if you put your button for intervention, it makes my work very easy. It's not on, but I'll give you the opportunity.
Speaker, is the distinguished senator for Kiambu, who is also the chair of my committee in roads, in order to mislead yourself and this country that the IEBC has no responsibility whatsoever in the creation and allocation of constituencies in this country? Madam Speaker, is he in order? Is he in order, Madam Speaker?
Madam Speaker, let me use my time,
Madam Speaker.
You will be given your time, so you don't need to worry about. You only have 1 minute left, and you'll get it.
You misled us through.
No.
You only have 1 minute anyway.
Please give the mic. Give Senator Mugeni the mic. You can come to the dispatch.
Yes, Madam Speaker, I watched the Senator for Kiambu, is my very good friend, doing a show on Citizen this morning and misleading 48 million Kenyans on the provisions of the Constitution. But I don't think we'll allow him to mislead the House. The Speaker, if Senator Matangi has ever read this Constitution, and I believe he has, he can go to Article 88 of the Constitution and read Sub-Article 4, Sub-Article C. Mr. Speaker, Madam Speaker, that constitution says that the function of IBC will be for delimitation of constituencies and wards. What he was telling the country in the morning relates to amendments of Article 89 and 97. And what he was saying, Kenyans have a right to propose amendments to those articles and increase constituencies from 290 to 360. But the function of delimitation under this constitution, Senator Matangi, is with a constitutional body called Independent Electoral Boundaries Commission. That is in black and white, and we must respect what the Constitution of Kenya says in Article 88.
Senator Matangi, please wind up.
Madam Speaker,
1 minute.
Madam Speaker, yes. We are reading the same constitution. There are not two constitutions, only one. And the senator, who is also a senior counsel, has read that part, which he says is delimitation. And I'm clear about my facts. Madam Speaker, Article 89.6 says that if necessary, the commission shall alter the names and boundaries of constituencies. Alter the names and boundaries. And the number and names of wards. And the constitution is clear. It goes to number of names and wards. The IEBC, Madam Speaker, the IEBC has got the power under our constitution to alter the boundaries of constituencies and not the number. But it has got the power to alter the number of wards, Madam Speaker. And that is my point. It starts by saying that there should be 290 constituencies. How would it start by saying there are 290 constituencies and then give the same IEBC the power to add the constituencies, Madam Speaker? And that's what I'm saying. 88 never anywhere in this constitution says that IEBC can add or alter the number. And that is why it is clear, 89.6. Please read. Read it. Madam Speaker, if I read 89.7 as requested, Madam Speaker, it says that in reviewing the constituency and ward boundaries, Madam Speaker, the Commission shall consult interested parties and B, progressively work towards ensuring that the number of inhabitants in each constituency and ward is nearly as equal as the population. Now, Madam Speaker, in compliance with that quarter, Madam Speaker, it does not propose at all that there will be extra constituencies created by IEBC. The constitution makers, Madam Speaker, had a valid case in saying that, Madam Speaker, and distinguishing between wards and constituencies. And that is the misdemeanor, Madam Speaker. I believe, Madam Speaker, that the wording on that is very, very correct, Madam Speaker. And that is my case, Madam Speaker.
Senator, you will get. Senator, please take your seat. Senator Ongeri.